No matter what political party you belong to or what you think of government, many of us agree that the number of taxes that Americans pay has reached alarming levels. I've talked about this before. There are more than 90,000 so-called governmental units across the country that can tax residents. They range from school districts to mosquito abatement authorities. We looked deeper and found that many of these units are called special taxing districts. And they provide a critical source of funding for many small towns. But as Mary Snow reports, critics say some of these districts are inefficient and need reform.
Fighting fires, lending books, providing clean, safe water. These are just a few basic services we expect from our local governments. But if you live outside a major metropolitan area, these services may be provided by an entity unfamiliar to most taxpayers. It's called a special taxing district.
Special districts over the past half century have really proliferated to the point that we have about 40,000 of them in the country now, and they account for about $100 billion of spending.
Simply put, a special taxing district is created by a state or local government to perform a specialized service. Firefighting is the most common, along with water, drainage systems, conservation, and hospital administration.
If this were the water district, it has its own little defined area within the township.
Woodstock, New York, a small town about 100 miles north of New York City, has created 7 special districts to provide its services.
It's density. In some towns, the population tends to cluster in one particular area. And so having separate wells and separate septic fields just becomes impractical.
All states have some kind of special districts, with most authorized to collect and spend taxpayer dollars. Steven Slavinsky is an economist with a libertarian think tank, the Goldwater Institute.
Usually a special taxing district will operate on property tax revenues. Many states will have transparency requirements to point out what specific type of tax levy is being levied on the property and to what type of government it's going to, whether it be the school district or the traditional local government or the special taxing district.
While this kind of special taxation may sound almost un-American, it has deep roots in the nation's history. Benjamin Franklin reportedly founded the first special taxing district back in 1736. That's when he created the Union Fire Company of Philadelphia, a volunteer department funded by a group of neighbors. Today, Illinois, California, and Texas top the list of states with the most special taxing districts. But even these figures don't include the tens of thousands of smaller districts providing very localized services, streetlights, for example. Given the sheer numbers, it's no surprise special districts often overlap.
They pile on top of one another in many, many layers. A school district may overlap with a park district, a water district, a sewer district, and so on, such that it wouldn't be at all uncommon for one person to be finding themselves within the boundaries of 10 or more of these districts.
Another problem critics charge, inefficiency.
There might be certain circumstances, like a rural area, where having a special taxing district makes sense. There might be other areas, though, where the special taxing district exists, not because it's the most effective or efficient way of doing something, but because there's a certain political dynamic that keeps it in place.
Now, states like California and New York are fighting the growth in special districts by rewarding local governments that consolidate.
I do think where you have separate commissions, that might be something where you could look at consolidation. But in the town of Woodstock, the Board of Trustees for the library and for the fire commissioners, these are unpaid positions. They're all volunteer. So it's not like you're getting rid of a lot of administrative costs.
Mary Snow, Al Jazeera.
Well, Benjamin Franklin may have created the first special taxing district, but apart from school districts, there were very few in existence until the New Deal. The Tennessee Valley Authority may be the most famous, but President Roosevelt encouraged the creation of hundreds of districts for municipal projects, public housing services, and soil and water conservation in farm states. Today, these districts are a way of life. I want to talk now about whether these special taxing districts are the best way to collect and spend the taxes you pay. And for that, I'm joined by a man who's advised New York Governor Andrew Cuomo, among others, on state and local government efficiency. He's Gerald Benjamin, political science professor at the State University of New York, and he joins us now at New Paltz. And he joins us now. Professor Benjamin, good to see you.
Good to be here.
I want to examine this a little more. Why? I mean, on one hand, it sounds very American, the idea that your issues are local, so you should pay for them locally and they should be decided locally. Sounds like a good idea that's somehow gotten out of hand. Why do we have such an explosion of these special taxing districts?
Well, the most recent reason is the tax limitation and borrowing limitation movement in the 70s and 80s in those states that have the initiative. So local governments were constrained in their taxing. And to deliver services while getting around the constraints, they created entities that were not constrained by the statutes or constitutional
provisions. Why are these not constrained?
Because the constraints were directed at general municipal governments, for the most part, and existing school districts. They didn't contemplate this development to the degree that it's occurred. So you can avoid the limitation by creating another entity that can then tax.
Right. A workaround, a loophole, if you will. Generally, in your opinion, good or bad that this loophole was created, that somebody creatively found a way around restrictions?
Well, I'm going to say that it's even worse. It's even worse than you describe, because there are layered general purpose governments as well, and layered school districts and so on. So my view is that complexity defeats democracy. People can't hold their governments accountable when they're
multiplicity of them,
we ask them to vote too much. We ask them to vote at the wrong times of the year when they're not paying attention to politics. There is low turnout. You advance overhead. Overhead gets higher because you have to maintain many entities. The problem of talking about this is that generalizations will apply but won't apply in specific cases.
Right. Because there are some that actually probably make sense.
Right. We would argue that there are some services have to be delivered at scale, and if you have to deliver them at scale, and the design of the general purpose government system is a 19th century design or an early 20th century design, then you have to get some kind of mechanism to do that.
Give me an example of a place where it works.
Well, I think that the example that immediately comes to mind are public authorities that are delivering transportation systems. Now, they're not within your definition because they're fee generated. They command taxes, but they're not directly taxing entities.
Many of them are toll. Right. They collect tolls, or the airports, or bridges.
Tolls, Thruway Authority. I come down on the Thruway Authority from New Paltz to New York, we pay those tolls, the bridges, and so on.
Professor, good to talk to you. Thank you for being with us.
It's great to be here. Thank you for inviting me.
All right.